In this lecture, I will be talking about ecological succession. So, ecological succession is process of change in the species structure of an ecological community over time. Now, this time is huge. It's in several hundred years. So, ecological succession may also occur when the conditions of an environment suddenly and drastically change. Now, it is quite possible that the ecological succession can take place at two places. Number one, the places where there is no life, and another one where the life has been devastated or it has been completely wiped off. So depending on what the origin is or how the life originates, there can be two different types of succession. Number one is primary succession, which occurs in essentially lifeless areas. So those areas which are incapable of sustaining any kind of life, such as those areas where volcanic eruptions are taking place, those areas where sand dunes are there, or rocky mountain areas are there, or in the places where the glaciers are retreating. Now the second one is the secondary succession. So it occurs in areas where a previously existing community has been removed. Now it could be because of the small scale disturbance, or it could be because of the large scale disturbance. Now the small scale disturbance could be, let's say, a fire in a forest. Large scale could be because of some kind of earthquake or some other kind of volcanic eruptions. So now these natural calamities could lead to the devastation or uprooting of the species which are already in the place. So all the trees, plants, they could be wiped off. Because of that, the different animals, birds, insects, bacteria, fungi which were surviving in that particular area, they are also wiped off. So primary succession begins in a place without any soil. So look at this particular image here. So here you will see that there are the bare rocks. So these bare rocks, they could be followed by growth of some lichens. Later it could be followed by growth of some mosses, followed by herbs and weeds. So these up to like three or four changes, they are counted in the category which is known as the pioneer stages, because these are some of the initial stages where these different life form or primitive life forms, they are coming up. Now comes the from herbs and weeds to grass, shrubs, pines, hickories, and some immature oaks. So these are somewhere named as intermediate stages. And finally, what we see is complete oaks, hickories, walnuts, maple, and different other kind of trees. So initially there was bare rock, and now we can see there are dense forest. So this final community is called the climax community. So you can see from this particular figure here that the life starts to begin from the bare rock and finished at the mature forests. So lichens, they begin to grow on the rocks. So over many years, lichens break down rock into sands. So you can see in this particular image here, different kind of lichens, they are growing up. So now weathering and the erosion of these rocks, as well as the presence of the lichens, they lead to formation of soil. So this rock converts into sand. Now lichens, they do not need soil to survive. So these lichens, since they have come up first, they are into the pioneer stages, so they are known as pioneer species. So the lichens, they grow, and some of them, they may also die. Now after the death of these lichens comes the decomposers. So these decomposers, they break down the lichens, and also the waste material of these decomposers, they enrich the sand. Now because the decomposers are also there, Now there is the beginning of nitrogen cycle. So eventually, because of the presence of the decomposers, lichens, and now the nitrogen cycle, the sand enrichment begins. There is eventually more and more enrichment of the sand that converts into soil. Now seeds, they could be ideally, they could be blown by the wind or they could be carried away by the animals from different regions. Now the simple plants like mosses, they can grow on the new soil. The plants grow and the soil gets enriched as the plants die. It's a kind of cycle. So the plants, they utilize the nutrients which are available in the soils, as well as they absorb water and sunlight, and they prepare their own new complex molecules. Now those degradation of those plants now further leads to the enrichment of that particular soil. Now because of the primitive or the initial plants, the soil gets enriched, and herbs and weeds, they can now grow in this thicker enriched soil. The simple plants, they die, adding more organic material. So the sand is becoming more and more converted into soil. So the soil layer thickens and grasses, wildflowers, and other plants, they begin to take. Now comes the number of the medium sized plants, animals, and other living beings. So the vegetation grows closer together, reducing the amount of free space. So more and more sand is converted into soil. More and more small plants, they are adding to the organic matter, and that is making the soil enrich. And because of the enrichment, more and more bigger trees, herbs, shrubs, they are coming up. Now once we have vegetation, then obviously small size, medium size animal, birds, they also come into that particular area. Now the competition and the lichens, competition between lichen and shrubs are there for the space. So eventually one species will die out and the other will survive. So that in that particular area, the lichens will be wiped off, and the mature or the shrubs which has come up into area, they will be mature. So the plants die and they add more nutrient to the soil. Shrubs and trees, they can survive now. Insects, small birds, and mammals, they begin to move in. So now because of the availability of large plants, there is availability of food. So that availability of food would dictate what kind of insects, birds, and animals will move in. So the bare rock, which could hardly support any kind of life, now it has converted into a different kind of lives. So these plants, they die, they add more nutrients to the soil, and large plants, they can now grow. So the soil is now very nutrient rich. Now because of that, large trees, they could also grow. The climax community. So a climax community is a mature, stable community that is the final stage of ecological succession. So initially there was rock, and finally there was bigger trees like walnuts, oaks, and pines. So those plants, those trees which have come up in the end, they will be staying for longer duration. So they are kind of mature and stable community, and they have come up in the end as well by crossing thousands of years. So now they are called as the climax community. So in an ecosystem with a climax community, the conditions continue to be suitable for the members of the community. So depending on what kind of location is. So if there is a tropical red forest, then we see dense forest. If it is a desert area, we'll see some thorny plants. If there is typical cold areas, mountain areas, we see there's hardly any kind of vegetation. So the climax community depends on the climatic conditions. So this climax community varies from place to place. So any particular region has its own set of climax species, which are the plants or the organisms which are adapted through that particular area. So these plants, they have evolved in such a way that they could easily survive in that particular area. and they will survive until unless there is any kind of major disturbance takes place. Then only it will be devastated, such as volcanic eruption, earthquake, or any kind of drought condition. Secondary succession. So let's say there's a forest where a fire takes place. So in that particular fire, the organisms, all the plants and bigger plants and trees, they will be destroyed. However, the soil will be safe. The soil, which may contain several kind of seeds, which may be usually from grass, weeds, or trees. So these seeds, they will be carried by winds or birds as well. So you might have seen a lot of examples that in the winters or during the springtime, we see that the vegetation has only large plants and trees. And even in the summers, all the grass and everything dries out. And as soon as the rainy season comes, a lot of grass, small plants, weeds, they quickly come up. The reason for that is that the seed of those plants is hidden in the soil. Or at times, these seeds, they could be blown from one place to another by the strong winds, or they may be moved by the birds itself. So the because of this, let's say, see this particular image here. Now, because of this fire, the devastation takes place, the whole trees, they die out. Now, the seed, the soil area, which has already thousands of seeds, now they'll start growing into annual plants. So those annual plants, they will be grown on the onset of rainy season or the availability of moisture and humidity. So these are usually grasses, and ultimately they will convert into some perennials as well. So the pioneer species here will be the annual plants. So then we have this intermediate species where grass, shrubs, pines, etc. grow, and ultimately it will be in the climax. So initially in the primary succession, there were thousands of years. However, in case of secondary succession, it's only 100 or 200 years. Since the soil is already enriched, it was already having different kind of seeds, so it is much faster. So in this case, secondary succession, the primary species are different. In case of primary succession, the primary species were lichens. However, in case of secondary succession, small annual plants, they are the primary species. And here the succession is a bit faster. So in secondary succession, the seeds which are in the soil, they begins to grow. So once we have small plants, small annual plants, then the larger shrubs, they could also come up in a couple of years. And followed by the fast growing trees such as pines. Now these are later followed by hardwood growing or the slow growing trees, which are the members of the climax community. So look at this particular figure here. So here we have, let's say, the annual weeds. So these annual weeds, they could later be followed by annual and perennial weeds. And ultimately, there could be some pine seedling saplings, they could be coming up. So these young pine trees, which are growing faster, now ultimately we have the final matured hardwood forest. So the whole timeline could be, let's say, around 150 to 200 years. So around 100-150 years of cultivation could lead to development of the fully matured forest. So those forests which were destroyed by the natural calamity, the fire which broke out into that particular area, that has now been taken care of. So the whole forest is again covered with the matured hardwood forest. Okay, so the ecology, this succession could be divided into different kinds. So we can have autogenic and the allogenic succession. So autogenic succession is brought about by the living inhabitants of that community itself. So it is a kind of example where the biotic components of the ecosystem plays a major role. For example, in case of secondary succession, the succession was brought up by the seeds, the plants itself. The soil, it was already having annual plants or the seeds of the different kind of weeds. So in a way, that is also called as autogenic succession. So it was brought about by the own members of the community, which were already flourishing in that particular area. Second one is the allogenic succession. So this kind of succession is brought about by the outside forces. Now the outside forces that could lead to devastation such as drought, fire or flood. So these kind of natural calamities, they completely wipe off the biotic components of the ecosystem. And eventually, after like 150 years or 200 years, these areas, they are again changed into forest. So the conditions or the abiotic factors which were responsible for the devastation and later the growth of the mature forest from the initial seeds of weeds, it could be driven by the ecosystem itself. So here, the change in the climatic condition or the natural sources could lead to the development of the whole area. So in the first one, it was the community itself. The second one, it was the major driving force is the natural resources. Then comes the autotrophic and the heterotrophic succession. So autotrophic succession, in which initially the green plants are much greater in quantity. So most of the time, the autotrophic succession takes place. So initially the lichens followed by mosses, later herbs and shrubs. So there is a huge number of autotrophic plants. Heterotrophic succession is where the heterotrophs are in greater in quantity. So in an area, it is quite possible that the autotrophs could be less, heterotrophs could be more. So that kind of succession which you brought up, where the heterotrophs are more, so those, that is called the heterotrophic succession. So succession in plants could be based on the nature of the habitat as well. So whether the plant or the area are growing in a wet area, that is the area where there is abundance of water, or they are in dry areas where there is scarcity of water. So those areas where the water is available in abundance, it's called hydrarch, and those dry areas, they are called xerarch. So hydrarch succession takes place in wetter areas, and the successional series progress from hydric to mesic condition. So it means that initially there is a lot of availability of water. Wetlands or wetter areas are there, then eventually it converts into those areas where is intermediate availability of water. In case of xerarch succession, it takes place dry areas. So here the succession or the progress is from xeric to mesic, that is from very dry to the intermediate conditions. So initially there is less availability of water. However, as the time passes by, the species which keep on moving, and that could also affect the abiotic components. So there will be intermediate availability of water after a couple of years of succession. So both hydrarch and mesarch succession, they lead to medium water conditions or the mesic conditions. So neither too dry nor too wet conditions are suitable for any kind of stable community. So with time, the xerophytic habitats gets converted to mesophytic one. So let's have a look at this particular figure here. So this shows succession in water. So initially what we see is that there's a lot of open water surface area, and there are some sludge puts out in floating runners. So what we see is that these sediments, they are deposit as and as moving from the coastal areas, from the shores of that particular water body. And the floating sludge, we keep on moving it. So there is less and less open water area. and eventually this whole area is covered by the sediments and the plants, they move onto the surface. So in primary succession in water, the pioneers are the small phytoplanktons. So they are replaced with time by free floating angiosperms, then by rooted hydrophytes, sedges, grass, and finally the trees. So the climax here again would also be a forest. So in the barren land, in the rocky areas, and as well as in the water rich areas, the ultimate climax is the forest. So with time and water, body is converted into water body. This huge water body, lakes and rivers kind of areas, they gets converted into water. Another important fact is to understand that succession, whether taking place in water or on land, proceeds to a similar climax community, that is the massif. So no matter what is the water availability, what is the content of water in that particular area, it will ultimately lead to the conditions where the water availability is intermediate. So it is possible that in some areas the water availability is less, in some areas the water availability will be more. So in those areas where less, the water availability will be increasing, and those areas where water availability is more, there the water availability will decrease. The level of moisture will also go down. Okay, so now there is a term which is called as homeostasis. So it is the maintenance of a stable equilibrium, especially through the physiological bodily part functions. So this is a kind of system where the body tries to maintain the internal environment. So let's say, for an example, in a very hot and humid day, especially let's say in summers, the organisms, they sweat more. So that sweating leads to the cooling effect. On the contrary, in a very cold day, the organisms, they try to conserve heat, either staying together close to the fire or maybe rubbing the hands and legs. So organisms, they try to maintain the constancy of its internal environment by a process called homeostasis. So no matter what the environmental condition is, they tend to change, they tend to maintain their homeostasis. The environmental conditions, they are there to disturb or to destabilize the homeostatic situation. But the organism tries to maintain in order to survive, in order to make it convenient for it to grow. So for humans, it could be achieved at home by using an air conditioner in summer and heater in winters. And the organisms, they have a different kind of setup. So on the basis of that, the organisms could have a different kind of physiologies. So some organisms, they are able to maintain homeostasis by physiological means, such as body temperature and constant osmotic concentration. So almost all the birds and animals and few lower vertebrates and invertebrates, they are capable of regulation. So now we can have thermoregulation as well as the osmoregulation. So these organisms, they are quite capable of maintaining their body temperature at a constant pace, called as thermoregulation. Or if the water content in the body is regulated, that's the osmoregulation. So the success of mammals is largely due to their ability to maintain a constant body temperature and thrive whether they live in Antarctica or in the Sahara. So these higher order animals or the organisms, especially the mammals, they have the capability to maintain constant body temperature. So the mechanisms used by most mammals to regulate their body temperature are similar to the ones that we use in humans. So increase in the heartbeat, increase in the blood flow, or doing some kind of exercise, or living in a closed area are some of the methods which are adapted by humans as well as the other organisms to maintain our body temperature around 37 degrees centigrade. In summers, when outside temperature is more than the body temperature, we sweat profusely. So the resulting evaporative cooling brings down the body temperature. In winters, the temperature is much lower than the 37, so we start to shiver. A kind of exercise which produces heat and raise the body temperature. So plants, on the other hand, do not have such mechanism to maintain the internal temperatures. Now the second method is the confer. So an overwhelming majority of animals and nearly all plants cannot maintain a constant internal environment. Their body temperature changes with the ambient temperature. So it's kind of that plants and animals, majority of them, they adapt to the external environment. So in aquatic animals, the osmotic concentration of the body fluid changes with that of the ambient water osmotic concentration. So these animals and plants, they are called as confirmers. So regulators were those were regulating the body temperature, confirmers which are kind of living or adapting the natural conditions. So thermoregulation is energetically expensive for many organisms. This is particularly true for small animals like shrews and hummingbirds. So those higher organisms which could capture more and more energy, or they could have more accessibility of the food or energy, they could only afford to maintain their body temperature. However, those organisms which have problem of availability of food or energy, for them the thermoregulation is a problem. So heat loss or heat gain is a function of surface area. So small animals, they have large surface area relative to their volume, so they tend to lose body heat very fast than when in a cold outside. So they have to expend much energy to generate body heat through metabolism. So this is because of the reasons that small animals, they are rarely found in areas where there's a lot of snow, especially in the polar regions. So during the course of evolution, the cost and benefit of maintaining a constant internal environment are taken into consideration. So species, they have evolved the ability to regulate, but only over a limited range of environmental conditions, beyond which they would simply confer. Now there's another method which is called the migrate. So if the organisms, they cannot maintain their body temperature, they cannot conform to the environment, then what to do? So these organisms, they can move away temporarily from the stressful habitat to a more hospitable area and return when stressful period is over. So one of the examples that I gave is the famous Kevladev National Park in Bharatpur in Rajasthan. So it hosts thousands of migratory birds from Siberia. So in the winters in the Siberia, the weathers are extremely cold. So those birds, those Siberian cranes, they move from those areas to this particular sanctuary. So they just migrate from one place to another. So next one is the suspend. In bacteria, fungus, and door plants, various kind of thick walled spores, they are formed. So neither they can regulate their body temperature, neither they can confirm, nor they migrate. So what they do, they just suspend their natural, normal metabolic activities. They can form spores. So lower plants and fungus, bacteria, they just form spores to avoid the unfavorable conditions. So in higher plant, seeds and some other vegetative reproductive structures serve as means to tide over periods of stress besides helping in dispersion. So they germinate into new plants when there is availability of moisture and temperature. Till then, they will just buried in the soil. So the seeds, they usually do it by reducing their metabolic activity and going into a state of dormancy. In animals, the organisms, if they are unable to migrate or avoid the stress, they just go for the hibernation. So this is what is extended during the winter. Okay, so this is what I wanted to tell in this particular slides.